Hi, mamas. I'm Lacey, your lactation counselor, and today you're listening to the Early Motherhood Guide podcast, where motherhood is simply supported. Today, I have the opportunity to talk with Kristina Lucia. Why don't you introduce yourself?
Thank you for having me. I am Kristina Lucia. I am the author of the Bella Lucia book series. The first book is coming out this spring. There will be a total of 5 this year, and that's just the first of the whole 15 of the series. And the focus of my books, the toys I create, the illustrations I draw, it's all about communication. The focus is being our true selves and being heard and hearing others. And my calling to this mission has been my own personal journey and seeing how different my life is when I'm able to identify not only my feelings, but the feelings of the other person and talk to them calmly. And as an aunt and as a godmother, I've witnessed this with my own relationship with the kiddos in my life. And I've also seen it with my own sister, who is a mom. She's a mom of a toddler. And just acknowledging, even though I feel like I'm a good kid person, like every time I'm around my nephew, and you know, you're a mom, like there's always something new. And there's something that I do with my sister is I say, oh, just like, because he's doing the hand motion, this more. And I say, oh, does this mean more? Just those simple things of acknowledging my sister as a mother, acknowledging that my sister is the one that is there day in and day out, living and breathing this life. And that respect and that communication has actually brought us closer and brought us deeper. And to me, writing these books is a way that I can gently come into your home and provide a resource, and also provide a resource in a way where you can adapt it. Now, like I said, I'm also a godmother, and my friend is an amazing mom too, but every mom is different. Every kid is different. And my main mission is to create these stories and the activities that are activities and beyond, which are on the back of each book. Again, it's designed for you to apply it to you and your family, because communication is unique to each of us. It's always evolving. What works today may not work tomorrow. And to create that space where we're able to adjust is really amazing.
Yeah, that's so true. I'm wondering about, you're saying communication is so important between a parent and a child. So why do you think that's important? And how do you think we can implement that into our daily lives?
I believe it's important because it's about hearing each other and understanding we are. I personally had a dysfunctional relationship with my own mom, even though it was built on a tremendous amount of love. And I see, when I think of my child self, I see the gaps. And also as I grew older, and went through puberty and things started pivoting, I saw how we had moments of communication that we lost. And unfortunately, I lost my mom before we could work on those things. However, I also realized too, because of the disagreements, because of the frustrations of not being heard, it led me to my healing path. And when I've seen it with my own family, with friends, the people I work with, when we're able to say, oh, this is why I'm feeling this. Like I was telling you before, I'll give a perfect example. I'm in the midst of launching my book series and, you know, working on getting those advanced reviews. And I was feeling anxious. I took a step back. I was like, okay, you're feeling anxious. What can you do? And so, you know, I wrote to my strategist, Melanie, and I said, hey, this is what I'm feeling. Is there anything else I can do? Like that guideline. And I realized with kids, it's different because they're still learning their communication patterns. They're still learning their feelings list. They're still learning what to do and say. And when implementing it on a daily basis, like one thing, and actually I have a gift for your audience, like one thing I really believe in strongly is coloring, because as an adult, and as a child, it has the same health effects in the sense of it calms us, it releases our emotions, it allows us to talk calmly, it also gives us ways to be creative.
Yeah.
And at any age, regardless if we're 5 years old, 35 years old, 85 years old, we all have an inner child and a critical parent. And that's the thing with kids. Kids are still developing. They're not necessarily in a space where they can go, mommy, my inner child is da, 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 da. You know, we need to give them that space. So with an activity like coloring, or I've heard from other parents, times it's taking a walk around the block. Mm-hmm. It's that opportunity to create a space where you and your child feel safe and they're able to communicate and they're able to feel acknowledged.
Yeah.
And that's actually something that I do in my books, where the character, main character Bella, who actually I have here with me, she likes to come on and say hello. She will say to her parents, you know, I'm feeling, because she's a child in the book. She's a child character, but I can't do this. Why? And the parent will relate to them as an adult, meaning, as an adult, I get scared. As an adult, I need to ask for help, and about that relatability. So when it comes to applying it on a daily basis, finding something that works for you and your child, where it's a space where you can both be calm and both hear each other. And the other thing I realized too for myself, and I've heard this from other adults too, is allowing the child to initiate, allowing them to feel safe and allowing them. And every child is different. You know, I had a moment that I could share where it was my friend's son, and he's adorable and I love him, but he did something. They were visiting me at my work and we were in the back garden in Midtown, and he did something and I didn't think it was a big deal. And I saw my friend react frustrated, and my inner voice went, shh, you don't know what happened at bedtime. You don't know what happened at breakfast. So that's the other thing too, I think, for people that are involved but are not involved in the day-to-day, is having that patience with your mom friends, your daddy friends, because you don't know. I mean, you don't know what happened, you know, an hour before.
Yeah,
you know, something happen. You're like, oh, what's the big deal? Like, hit through a piece of paper. Like, but no, maybe this is like a constant thing and it's something that parent is trying to break, you know. Or maybe, you know, even though my sister and my other girlfriends tell me things, like, again, I'm not there with them constantly. Like, I'm not living and breathing this life. And there's something too about respecting people where they are. But I'll never forget that moment of seeing him and my friend, like, what's the big deal? And that in my inner voice, like, no, you need to respect her. She knows what's best for her child. And you don't know. You just don't know what happened. So, but yeah, it's but it's definitely an evolution. It's definitely an evolution and an awareness that we each need to develop in our own way, in our own time.
Yeah, for sure. And I love having it something so simple as, you know, sitting down and coloring, or reading the books, right? Because even as adults, like, we weren't necessarily taught with those communications with our kid either by example. You know, like you were saying, maybe when you were a kid, some of us have had, hey, I see that you're feeling, and validating that feeling and working through it together, but most of us have not, you know? And so your automatic reaction is not to be like, wow, you seem really angry right now. You know, like, understanding, like, yeah, I could see that would be frustrating. That's not an automatic, and that has to be learned from both the parent and the child. And having something as simple as like that connection time, if you're mm-hmm. sitting and coloring. And I think in our mind, we have this idea as parents to have that sit down connection time, it has to be perfect. I have to have all the things prepared, having those moments, right? And a lot of times those moments just don't happen. And so if it's as easy as reading this book that can help learn about communication, or having them having simple coloring book, that will be so simple. So with coloring, I absolutely love that it's something that's so simple and something you can mm-hmm. easily implement, right? It could be just, hey, after nap time, we're going to reconnect, right? And just sit down and read a book or color. And you can like learn so much from that if there's like a dialogue, right? Already that you're learning from in a book. And hearing you talk about like your mom and how that it must be such a healing for you. I can't imagine how that would feel, you know, not being able to have the opportunity to reconnect with her and work those things out. Like, how is that? And is these are these books, is that an inspiration for you from that? Is that healing for you?
It is. When I started my pivot, it actually I my pivot started in two different places. Like my career pivot started in 2018 when I injured myself, and I knew on that table, I'm gonna be back on the dance floor. And I was back on the dance floor in less than 4 months. And I even went in to the studio on the day of my surgery to say hello to my coach. And she asked me who I kicked. And I said, oh, my instructor. And she laughed because she's known this guy for like years and years and years. They're really good friends, is how I became friends with her. And that was like my career pivot. But what really started my healing pivot is my mom and I had a really, really bad fight. So fast forward to 2019, because I was already in this pivot, so I got laid off. At least I had certain things set up, and I was still not ready to say I'm an entrepreneur. And I kid you not, it was, I didn't know at the time, but it was 2 weeks before my mom's passing, maybe a month before, that I declared myself an entrepreneur. And then I found out she was ill. I swear it was my grandma, because that's why I'm a Lucia. I'm named after my grandma, Lucy. I got this urge after I got off the phone with my father and sister to file for my LLC. And the day she died, I held a piece of mail in my hand, and it was the letter saying that my LLC was approved. And I knew it was my grandma and mom, and I knew they were saying, we need you to do this. And yesterday, when I was like feeling anxious, like, and again, like as an adult woman, like my healing journey, that was one of the first things my therapist said is, how are you feeling? And I could not answer that question. I had no idea. I was like, what do you mean? How am I feeling? I'm feeling okay. She's like, that's not a feeling. Are you sad? Are you anxious? And I actually keep a PDF of my feelings list on my Mac, so I can access it easily when I'm writing or even when I'm struggling with myself. And again, it's a skill as a grown woman. I'm still learning how to do this, So I do see it as a huge sign, and that she drew me to this, because originally it was just these stuffed characters that I created. I didn't have my blogs at that point. I just started launching my own podcast. Like I didn't have that, and I realized, like, by that sense of faith and knowing that mom and grandma and my great grandma were saying, we need you to do this. We need you to pursue this. And so it definitely is cathartic. And I also realized too that my mom was doing the best of what she had. She was dealing with her own demons. And as again, this is a healing process to get to the point that I am where I'm able to say this, to say I recognize she was dealing the best of what she had. She really was trying to be the best mom possible. And I really appreciate what you said about the pressure to have all the things, because as a B2C business, I'm on IG a lot. I'm interacting with influencers and mommies, and I see this pressure to have the most beautiful cakes and the most beautiful things and da da da. And I hearing you as a mother say those connection points happen when you're reading a book in a quiet space, or you're at the kitchen table coloring before dinner's being made. Those are the beautiful moments, and I recognize how my mom was always trying to get those moments. Like she really was trying to be the best. And although I can't undo what was done, I can heal from it, but also I can be the best version of myself. And my sister actually got married about a month and a half before she got sick and passed. And then actually her first baby she had, who's now two, they had him within, like, it was only their first anniversary, and Caleb came a couple of days later. I feel like when you become an aunt, and I'd already been a godmother for a while at this point, you realize that it's not just about you anymore. You realize you have a responsibility. And in all fairness to my mom, I look like my mom, I act like my mom. She had a lot of beautiful qualities, which I was blessed to. There were a lot of beautiful qualities about her where people say, like, this is Linda, like you remind me of Linda. And I do see this. And part of my healing journey is in my dedication for my first book. I actually say that this first book is dedicated to my trinity of angels, great grandma, grandma, my mom. And I do say that my acknowledgments that our relationship was not perfect, but it was built on love.
Yeah.
And another thing I say too is I mention kids in my life, but my nephew, I do pluck out because it's blood. So you're allowed to give blood a little shout out. And I say, thank you for making me the best version of myself. Like, I do feel this responsibility, not just to me, but to him, to my godchild, to everyone, that to you and all the other podcasters who give me these opportunities. I want to present the best version of myself. And I've seen things evolve, and something that I noticed with my own mom, when we talk about communication, is I notice like something that this is going to sound really, really crazy, but it's so true. So when we would have a family gathering, like a bridal shower, or a baby shower, my mom would insist on buying a gift with me. Now, for some of this, I didn't care, because let's face it, bridal shower, it's practical. I really am not going to fight with my mom over a vacuum versus a Swiffer. Like, I'm just not, but baby shower, it's more fun. You know what I mean? It's, you can be a little more creative. And so I would race to buy something like the day I got the invitation. Yeah. Because again, there wasn't that communication with my mom and I, where I was like, Mom, I want to be recognized as an independent woman. And there was another wedding where she told me, don't write a check. I'm writing the check for the family. And I still wrote a check because, again, like my mom, were in a place where I could say, Mom, I was invited. I want to be financially responsible. Like, I want to pay for my plate. Like, I had a gift for that cousin and her husband. Like, I made something for them. I like to make something. And then I write a check and like to balance out like my budget. And, but again, we didn't have the communication. However, recognizing that we didn't have that communication, that I wasn't able to say, Mom, this is upsetting me because I feel you're not respecting me as a responsible grown woman. Now, flip side of this is because of recognizing that. So like I'll use my sister as an example. I do this with all my girlfriends. I always ask them when I'm buying gifts, what are the kids into? Or if it's something more family oriented, I ask, hey, would you like this? Like, cause I love to bake and cook. And so I thought it'd be really cute to get kid aprons, like my goddaughter and her brother. And my friend said, no, actually, I don't like the kids in the kitchen. So I scrapped it because, again, it's disrespectful to give a parent a gift they don't like. And with my sister, so my nephew likes the real thing. He's only two, but he likes the real thing. And his grandma bought him like a play vacuum cleaner and he hates it. He'd rather have the real vacuum cleaner attachment, which made it into one of the Christmas pictures, And so I asked my sister and my brother-in-law, like, because he loves the kitchen, I'm like, should it be real? And they're like, yes, he's going to sense it. Like, if you're going to get him something, get him a real size, get him a kid size tool, but real. And again, it's about that communication.
Yeah.
It's about acknowledging they know their child best. Like, they're the ones that are going to have to like store this in their house. It's about respecting them. Cause all my girlfriends tell me it's either, especially my girlfriends more so than the men, like I hear it all the time. There's always that one family member that gives that obnoxious gift that like, and as the aunt, as the friend, you hear about it. And again, that's also communication, like recognizing, okay, this is a sore spot. I should not be giving things like this to the child. Like, this is not a good idea. Like, don't do that. So when you, again, even as adults, like it's an evolution and, asking those gentle questions, asking for those boundaries, we hear about boundaries all the time with like timeouts as, for toddlers and whatnot, but even as adults, we need to take a timeout and we need to say, okay, pause. I thought I was being thoughtful, but nope, I'm not. So scrap that. Let me look into something else. Like, let me look into something else. Cause at the end of the day, that's also going back to that feeling list and realizing I'm looking for a way to love my friends. I'm looking for a way to love my family. And I want to show love. I don't want to cause anxious. I don't want to cause anger. I'm looking to add happiness and smoothness to the household.
It's very big of you to recognize, right? Because when you're trying to talk with somebody, with sisters and sister, sometimes it can work well, sometimes it cannot. I think it depends on the relationship. But a mother and daughter, it is so much harder to have that conversation and be like, hey,
Oh
like,
gosh, that's
yeah. And even that honest communication, it doesn't always go well because that's not what they're used to, right? But
yeah.
it's something so nice and healing and like learning from that you can do that with your sister and do it with your nephew, right?
Yes,
And with your friends,
yes.
you know, and respecting, like, hey, okay, so I understand, like, you don't want to store that in your house, or that's not the most thoughtful gift. 'Cause, yeah, we all have that, like, that annoying toy that a friend gave that you press the button and and you're like, it's in my sleep, I hear this song, you know, and you're like, I can't wait till this thing dies. So I totally understand.
Oh my gosh. My nephew got a micro excuse me, not a microwave, a kitchen with microwave with buttons. And I told my sister, I said, I'm making a bet, like how long till it breaks or how long till you and your husband take out the batteries. Cause it's like one of the, because of course it's all he's doing is pressing that one button. I mean, he loves it. He's having a good time, but like it's just kind of funny because the struggle's real. And no, I totally agree. And like something else that happened after my mom's passing. So I mentioned to you before we started recording off, I'm an Italian family. And, you know, I've been excuse me, I've been baking and cooking since I was a little girl. I mean, I was 12 years old to make homemade pizza dough from scratch. So like I've done it all. And the first year my mom passed, well, first or second year my mom passed, we were working out the Christmas menu, who was doing what. And I saw that other people were doing the ravioli. And I was just in charge of laying out food. And honestly, I'm the cook, I'm the baker. And my healing, my communication led me to approach my siblings and say, hey, you know, which was true. My mom liked to be in control. That's how she survived. That's how she thrives. That's why I was only allowed to fork press the ravioli. So literally, they were regurgitating what they had witnessed all these years. We had never talked about it. And so I stepped up to the plate and said, you know, it really meant a lot to me to do the raviolis or help or do another dish because, you know, mom wouldn't let me. And it was actually my sister that came to me and said, yeah, let's do it together. And the past 2 years, I've made the raviolis on Christmas Day.
Oh, nice.
I think it's really beautiful. It's really beautiful because it came from that moment. And again, I recognize like if my mom was living, I would bite my tongue because it's my mom and I respect my mom. And, you know, I may have to go through the back door. I guess it's not as easy to be direct as I am with my own sister and my brother. But I realized, no, you need to step up and say this. And with my own mom, so I'm a little bit of the devil. So when one of my siblings was going through something, I said, Mom, I'm not commenting. Like she would get upset with me. And one time I actually told her, she got really mad. I told her, you need to start respecting so and so as a married individual. They're engaged. She's like, no, they're only engaged. I'm like, Mom, they're grown, they're engaged. Like, oh. And so I was a bit of a devil to my mom. I mean, I wouldn't say a devil, but like, but again, it was scary, you know, it was scary, but I recognized too, I could do it for my siblings. I couldn't do it for me though, to a certain degree, you know what I mean? Because when I would try to do it with her, we would, because my mom unfortunately suffered from narcissism as well. There were mishaps in the communication. And even when I did it with my siblings, but also I'm the oldest, and my mom raised me to have more of a motherly personality. And I actually had to stop that because when I'm in a group, like I see myself become the mom. Like I'm the one holding the birthday flowers. I'm the one lighting the candles and singing happy birthday to everyone. Or someone spills something, I'm like, where are napkins? Let's clean this up, you know? And so I recognize I need to take care of myself. Like I need to, like sometimes I need to step back, like Christina, no, they're grown adults. They can figure it out. It's okay. There are paper towels. They will find them. You don't have to be the mom of all moms. But that's another thing with communication is I realized, oh, like I need to do this for me. And honestly, looping back to what you said about the books being healing, the books have taught me to stand up for myself. Like when I first started writing, I was with a different team that I left. Now I'm with a team that really understands me and gets me. And I've been drawing since I was 7 years old, and that was a big thing for me. I was like, I am illustrating my own books. I am designing my book cover. I mean, my layout person does the layout of the book cover, but it's my illustration on the book cover. And that was a big thing. And you know, there was discussion over my font and I was like, no, it needs to feel me. But these are all from dealing with these things with my mom. I realized, no, you can't keep people pleasing. You can't keep sliding it under the rug. Like, you need to do what's right for you. And, you know, I've seen it with my girlfriends, and I imagine you've seen it in your own parenting journey and your friend's parenting journey as well. Like, there comes a point where you have to kind of step back and do what's right for you. Cause I see it on social. I see the opinions. I see this and that. And my sister said something really powerful to me when I was with her 2 weeks ago and said, you know, you can Google anything. You can Google anything and find what you want to hear. And it's true. And it's like, I heard her say that. I was like, oh my God, that is so scary. You are so right. Like, you can figure out whatever answer you want if you do, you're willing to do enough digging. And, but then again, your gut. And again, that goes back into understanding the feelings, us being able to talk. And again, it's like learning to walk. And I'm still learning to identify my feelings. Like, I still have to step back and be like, okay, how am I feeling? Yeah. Why am I feeling this way? How am I going to get through this? Like, and it's, and I'm a grown woman. And so I can only imagine how it is for a little kid and what's going through their head. And it's, yeah, circle's real.
Yeah, it is. And essentially, if you have somebody changing your book so much, like, it's not you anymore, right? So,
I
mean, you must have poured so much into these, saying that you've like painted all the illustrations.
Well, that's the thing too. It's so much of your heart and soul. And that was actually something else that came up as well when I first started writing. So I was between the idea of traditional and self-publishing. And I actually was on the phone with an agent for over 2 hours because I'm a saleswoman. Like, I am a saleswoman. I know this is also where my mom had a bit of a riff, because my mom was a little bit more introverted than me. She was a little shyer than me. And I tend to, I just have a salesy personality. You know what I mean? Like, I've had people help work with me on finessing pitches and finessing approaches, but when it comes to me walking in a room, like, I can work a room pretty like easily. Like, it doesn't bother me. And that was, I got on the phone with this agent and I immediately started, oh, I loved how you said this in your presentation, you know, that zinger to get their ears. And that comes to me very naturally. So we were on the phone. That was my point of saying I'm a saleswoman. We were on the phone, and people that know that are listening, to get an agent on the phone for that long, like, they're the personality in and out, money, no money. And so we were talking, and then my editor and I had a deep conversation, my marketing strategist and I had a deep conversation, and I realized self-publishing was right for me, because with traditional, you are fitting into their boxes. And I knew from the get-go there were certain boxes. Like, for example, I'm a Catholic woman, and so Bella does say her blessings at the end of every book. You know, I am very feminine. I am very girly. Obviously, my painted nails, like, I'm always like, are they chipping? Like, do they look good? You know, and so Bella wears dresses, you know, and I love to cook. So Bella loves to cook. And there are certain things that her mom does with her, because that's what my mom did with me. But then there are certain things my dad did with me. So that's what Bella's dad does with her. And, you know, I have a lot of friends that are Orthodox Jewish, that I have certain friends that are atheists, but I also have friends of the LGBTQ community. You know, I have a lot of homosexual friends that are married and have kids. And, you know, I've spoken to my friends of different religions. I've especially spoken to my gay friends. And I said, you know, I'm not comfortable telling this story. Just because I'm friends with you, just because I'm friends with someone that celebrates the Sabbath on a weekly basis, just because I'm friends with someone that is of the gay community, that is married and raising a child, doesn't mean that I have the knowledge to authentically write that. And the way I'm writing these books is so that those communities can read it and they can feel comfortable. Mm-hmm. It's about relatability. It's about being your true self. And it's maybe a little off topic, but when I watched the old, I remember as a kid watching Ellen DeGeneres come out. And when I watch those interviews now, when I'm watching the parents and the Catholics who were there and disagreeing with her, what I'm hearing is, and nothing to do with our sexual orientation. It had to do with control. of when their children were exposed to certain things. And honestly, you can't control people. They are going to learn what they're going to learn. They are going to be who they are going to be. And I personally admire women like Ellen and so many, and obviously Barbara Walters just passed, the great Barbara Walters. Like, I mean, I think she was amazing. Yeah. I might be biased saying that. But again, I really believe it's about being your true self. Like, one of the things I remember, not to jump all over the place, but I remember Barbara Walters, is that they thought she was, they put her in there because she had an attractive face. And she didn't want that. She wanted substance. She was educated. She was smart. She was cunning. And I feel the same way with Ellen. You know, she created a space where we can be ourselves, our true selves. And as a straight Catholic woman, I want to be able to do that, you know, and same with all those parents that are looking for ways to adapt their communication to their child. Like, I'm not looking to say this is the right way to help your child transition. This is the right way to do this. Like, no, it's not. It's about you saying, oh, okay, maybe I can do this way. You know, like I said, if you have the child that doesn't want to sit still and color, you know, maybe like my nephew is like, you know, he's not into coloring quite yet, but he loves the lawnmower. So maybe it's your husband and the child going on the ride on lawnmower and riding around the backyard. You know, maybe it's that, you know, there's no set, like one size fits all, you know, and that's the beauty of this world, is that we're able to adapt and make it work.
For sure. So you're saying your books are about transitions in life. I would love to know, so what are the stories? What transitions, what kind of transitions are in the books? Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. So what I did is I chose transitions and skills that we all go through. So the first five that are going to come out, this first book is Bella's Big Girl Bed, where she goes from a crib to a big girl bed. The next one, she is learning to read. The third one, she's learning to get dressed. So zippers and buttons and tying shoes. And she's going to be learning to ride a bike. And then the holiday one of this year is Bella's Christmas cookies, where she learns she can't find a gift in the store that's right for everyone, all of her friends. So she actually makes cookies with her mom, and she's able to help that. And then the further books, I'm actually, although I have five ready to go, the one I'm working on right now, actually we're bumping five till next year because it's going to be Bella's Christmas cookies, which I just finished writing and my editor's working on, and I'm illustrating sooner than later. So there's going to be, in the next five, she's going to be learning math. She's going to be gardening, like learning how to grow a garden. There's going to be a Halloween one. There's going to be more Christmas stuff, but I really wanted to hone on things that we all go through. You know, one thing that I often say is if we strip away our sexual orientations, our genders, nationalities, where we're from, where we were raised, our ages, we all work from that same feelings list. And, you know, we all go from a crib to a big kid bed. You know, we all learn math. We all learn to read. We all learn to get dressed. You know, Halloween and Christmas are a little more specific, but again, it's still that we have holidays that we celebrate. And, you know, and in the last, within the last 15 and 11 through five, like Bella, so I love to travel, and Italy and Paris are two of my favorite areas of the world. So Bella is going to go travel later in the series. And again, I'm still working on those plot lines, but again, that will be things we go through, like being on a plane for the first time, being in a foreign space, like missing your friends, like, my brain's always like thinking, oh, what is the plot twist? Like, what is that? But again, it's all about that relatability. You know, I wanted to put a little bit of myself in there. So it's authentic, obviously. And so it's my true self. But at the same time, I wanted something that people could relate to. So for example, if you're not like, oh my gosh, I can barely do Bisquick, Kristina. How in the world am I to relate to this? We can all relate to going, trying to find something special for our friends, for a party. You know, we can all relate to gathering and why that's special, you know? And so that's what I'm always going for, you know, but at the same time, in light of what I was saying before, I realized it's important to be if I'm saying like my mission is to be your true self, I realize I have to demonstrate that first and foremost. Like I need to live fully, you know, I need to demonstrate like this is me and not apologize for it. And that's hard not to apologize. Like it's something else I've been working on a lot and I still work on it constantly is that apology factor. Cause it's easy. It's really easy to do, but it's worth the struggle working through it.
Yeah, it is. And I think especially as a firstborn, you know, I've read all about the order, birth order, and especially, you know, you're the little mama, you know, and so I'm sure that is a lot. Yeah.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah.
I'm hearing all the, hearing the stories and like the plane for the first time. And so I can right now see exactly, because my kids just went on a two out of three went on a plane for the first time. And so now I could see how beneficial it would have been to have a book to explain going on a plane for the first time. But for other transitions and other stories, what do you think, how do these stories help your child go through these transitions?
I think they help. The way I see it helping is a gentle way to introduce it. You know, story time is, I'm really big on the love languages. And ironically, I'm a toucher. I love through touch. I like to be loved through touch. So I think that's why I love kids so much. Like I love snuggles. And that with my nephew, like I struggle not to claw for him whenever I see him. Like I really have to hold back and be like, Kristina, give him a space. Like he will come to you. It's okay. but I do feel that intimacy of story time and a lot. It's very rare where I don't hear of a family ending their bedtime ritual without a story. And there's something about that repetitiveness and something else with the familiarity of reading these stories and the characters is I've seen this and I've heard this from other parents is that the child will talk through the character, meaning, oh, well, Bella did this. We need to do this too. Or it's that familiarity and it's almost like having a friend. It's almost like having a friend that it's, and again, there's something about that intimacy of reading together and spending time together quietly and really identifying. And that's why I do feel it's so important. I'm grateful for myself that I'm a crocheter and a knitter. Yeah. And then I can create the toys because like part of my venture this year too is to start looking into manufacturing because I will always have the handmade option. But with that said, even looking into the manufacturing option, I'm very gung-ho about all my toys not having sounds, not having bells and whistles. Because again, like if you have, like, for example, I'm just giving like a broad example. My books are out at this point in the year. You have my toys, you have my books, you're reading my books to your child, and your child takes Bella and is like, you know, Bella's nervous about the slide. Like, what can, you know what I mean? Like, I've seen, I've had parents tell me what parents have had these, I've had my toys that will say their child talks to the toy. Like, you know, Bella's scared of the thunderstorm. She needs to sleep with me, or Bella needs a light on. There's something. I've seen it, and honestly, I've seen adults do it, and it's funny because I see adults do it to their phones. Like I see them when they're scared, like go on their phones and scroll when they're in a party, and I'm like, okay, they're like, no, like we're at a party, like why are you on your phone? But then I realize, wait, that's their.
Yeah.
I always joke because I'm a Snoopy girl. I always joke that's their Linus's blue blanket. Like that's like our phones are that. So when we see kids, like I feel kids are more upfront with it. And even my own nephew, he's all about trucks. The garbage truck is his favorite thing in the entire world. And I joke because I was at the Macy's Day Parade this year. I finally got to see it live. And I took a picture of the trucks at 5, 6 a.m. and told my sister, so Louie's not coming for another 3 hours, but honestly, I think Caleb's going to enjoy this much more. And she's like, yeah, he is. Like, he could really care less about the balloons. But I've seen him carry around his truck. Even it was so funny this summer because the truck was broken, but he still held onto it. And so there's something about that comfort. And I see how he gravitates towards books and that repetition. And there are things. And granted, he's starting to speak now and he's developing more skills. But
yeah,
when you're reading these stories and it's just a gentle way to introduce the concept. And you'll give, again, like with the coloring we talked about earlier, giving them that space to come to you and bring it up, as opposed to feeling forced into it. And with that said, I get it. We're humans. We all need boundaries. Like, there are times where we'd rather be sitting on the sofa watching TV, but we need to clean the kitchen, or, you know, and as kids, like, it's the same thing. Like, at any age, we have those moments, but there is something empowering, whether it's the child or the parent, having that opportunity to be able to present something in a non-threatening way. And I feel storybooks are a great way to do that, because it's just a gentle way of consistency.
It is. And it also gives you that dialogue, right? I have read this book called Playful Parenting, which was great, because it's kids learn through and work through things through play, you know? And so having like the dialogue through the book, and then having the character to play with, and like really working through, like, oh, you know, like really, you know, Bella's scared of the big girl bed and being all by herself, you know, like, and then working through the story, and then having like my daughter, I can think of, like, she would love to work through that and like comforting. Yeah. She's such a little mama, and just like taking care of it, and like, oh, it's okay. Like, it really is like so helpful when you're going through that, you know?
Absolutely. Yeah. But the other thing too that I've learned from my journey, and it's funny because like now that the holidays have dwindled down, like there are, when the kids are little, and I saw this with my own mom, you know, we all have an inner child and critical parent, and it is a skill. It's a skill I'm still working on of identifying that. And I see how with my, I'm speaking from my own mom and other moms that I've observed, Elf on the Shelf, Santa, these are all opportunities for us as adults via calendar age, to nurture our inner child. And I saw how when I hit my teens, and then my siblings hit their teens, that my mom lost some of that playfulness. And so when we talk about this too, you know, again, like, I've noticed this with my own personal journey with my mom, how important it was, not just to me, but to her. And so, and again, this is something that you just have to live. I mean, you just have to figure it out. Like, it's not going to be perfect, but there is something about, I feel, having it in the back of our minds and being aware of it. And I've had multiple parents say to me, like, when a child gets sick, like, I never forget when my former coworker said to me, you always have that, oh wow moment where you don't know what's wrong, and then you figure it out, and next time it happens, you're good. But you have to go through that. Like, you have to go through that. Okay, my child's ill. How do I deal with this? Like, what is it? This isn't working. This isn't working. Okay, this is working. Now I know. And it's no, in a sense, it's no different. And so when we talk about, you know, Elf on the Shelf and whatnot, and my marketing strategist, Melanie, like, we're actually already plotting for the holidays 2023, because again, you have to be ready by November 1st. And I love Christmas, so it's really not like, it's actually on my island. I'm like, great, Christmas all year, fabulous. But, you know, she was showing me this group text of these mommies, and they're all posting their Elf on the Shelf stuff. And it was so neat, because, and I honestly thought, wow, it's just as important to the mom and the dad as it is to the child. And, you know, obviously they're doing it for their kids, and they want their kids to have the best Christmas season, which is beautiful and lovely. But there is that moment of, no, you need this too, as a grown adult. Like, you need to nourish that little girl, that little boy, you know, they need to play. And so I could see too, how that playful parenting is really fun. Cause like, I know me, I'm the one that's on the floor playing with the kids. Like, I have this thing with my nephew where he gives me a play phone, and even without the play phone, I use my fingers. Like, I'll go, ciao, ciao, hello. And he just lights up. He thinks it's the greatest thing. And I love saying, I'm like, ciao, ciao, hello. Yes. Yes. And like, so play does come to me very naturally. I acknowledge that. But it was so funny, cause this Christmas season, I really like had this epiphany. I'm like, oh my gosh, like, this is, I'm talking about inner child all year long. Like, this is so important. Like, I should be recognizing this and thinking like, oh, how do I present this, you know, in a gentle way? Because obviously everyone's inner child is different. Like, the way I approach it as different than the next person. And there's no right or wrong again. It's all about communication and nourishing, you know.
Yeah, for sure. Being an author, and I personally, so for you, I love reading books. I absolutely love it. So I was curious, what is your favorite? Do you have a favorite book that you love, that you've got a lot of influence from with writing?
Oh my gosh. So I have a couple of favorites. I think the one I'll give though, because I'm always that one that's like, let me give like 10 answers for one question. I'm totally that woman. I'm not gonna lie. The book that comes to mind, and I've read it so many times, like I'm well into double digits, is The Time Traveler's Wife. And one of the reasons why I love it so much, and I actually steer away from the movie and the series because I'm so deeply invested in the book. Like, I get it. I'm an author. Like, I get the strategy. I understand, but I'm a romanticist and an imaginative woman. I need space to imagine.
Yeah.
When I read that book, there's so many Easter eggs. And I keep on picking up on more and more things. Like, sometimes when I read it, I'm like, oh my gosh, this is mom's birthday. Or, oh my gosh, this is my brother's birthday. Or, oh wait, this is what happens like later in the book. Cause like Claire mentions like, Tara and Henry, you wrote on that thing about the baby. And I'm like, oh my God, this is what happens at Kendra's office. And I'm like, I get so excited, you know? And I just love the characters. I just adore them. And my grandpa's name is Henry. And we lost him many years ago. And he was just so adorable. And I loved him. So I have a sore spot. I have a very big soft spot for that name. But it's those Easter egg factors. And that's why I'm also, in addition to books, I'm a huge reader as well. I love to read. I'm also a big movie person. And again, I look for movies with those Easter eggs. And I forget the last name of her, but I believe her first name is Audrey. But what Audrey's writing reminds me a lot of what Alfred Hitchcock does in his movies. I'm a huge Hitchcock fan. And I think as a children's author, how can I do this? Like, how can I insert these Easter eggs? So when we're talking about big picture, for Bella, like I have already started manifesting for her to go to animation. And I've actually said this because I'm very adamant about, I'm going to be the voice on the audiobooks. You know, I'm the face of the brand. You hear my voice all the time. But with animation, I want to put a little Hitchcock meeting, or like what Audrey does in Time Traveler's Wife. I want to be a different character in each series and have like two or three lines max, like, or enough that you can hear my voice. Yeah. So I could be the shop clerk, or I could be the cleaning lady, or I could be the mailwoman. But I want it to be so that the kiddos are like, where's Aunt Christina's voice? Where's her voice? So seeing Audrey do that in her writing, I'm like, wow, I want to do that for the parents that are trusting me. Like, I really value you and all the men and women that are in the parenting journey and are trusting me and are listening to my words and reading my books and allowing Bella to enter your homes. Like, I want to provide the best quality. So to me, if I can provide you a little Easter egg or something fun on that 100th read of one of my books, it's like, that's what I'm here for. I'm here for both of you. And that's the thing with children's, I tell people like, who are like, well, why children's? Why this? Why that? I'm like, because a lot of times too, I feel people tend to hear I'm a children's author, even though I write two different blogs and I write for adults. They're like, oh, children's. Oh, well, whatever. I'm like, no, children's is a lot more complicated for many, many reasons. Like, there's a lot of things you can't fake the way you can fake adult books. And also, you have two different clients in mind. You're catering to both the parent and the child. You have a responsibility to both parties. It's not an either or, you know, this is a responsibility. This is a value add to someone's life. It's like, you know, so I do. And that's part of what I love about it. I love the fact that I'm able to be invited into someone's intimate community. It's really beautiful. It's a really beautiful opportunity.
It is, and I love that too. When you are reading or watching a movie or a series, it's like, it makes it so much more enjoyable because you didn't pick that up last time, you know, and you're like, oh yeah. I'm not a huge, I don't feel like I have a lot of time to watch shows or movies anymore, but before kids, I loved the show Arrested Development, and they have those little things put in throughout the whole series, and you can watch that whole series like 10 times and you're like, oh, like they plan that from like season one and it's season four, you know, and so it's really enjoyable. But so yeah, as a parent reading the same books 100 times, I appreciate those little surprises.
Absolutely. Well, because Sex and the City is one of my all-time favorite TV shows, and that's part of the reason why I feel it's so timeless, is all those Easter eggs, and the writing is so strong. And so as a children's author, because the word count, you really do have to cap it. Like, 'cause I'm definitely one that can write. And that's why I love blogging, because I feel like there's no rules. I'm like, oh, I came back from this trip and I had this epiphany. Let me write about this. You know, I feel like it's just fun. And like, why not? Like, why not write about this? And I see how crisp and clear the writing is. And again, I love it when they show snaps of Carrie's closet and it will be season five, but there's a dress from season two. And it's those little things, or just seeing how her space and the space of the other characters is growing and developing. And I think of that too as I'm drawing this series, as I'm writing this series, because my editor and I have actually already had the conversation about, well, who is Bella going to be when she grows up? And my editor has already said to me, when we reach 15, like, are you open to writing a book for the older kids? Meaning like the pre-teens or early teenagers. I said, yeah, why not? And I realized that will be a different writing skill that I will develop, which I'm excited to develop when the time comes, you know. And it's ironic too, because the second blog that I wrote, I write, I do write, I write it. Sorry, my words. That I write, someone brought it up to me and said, where was the inspiration for this? And it's, I call it Diaries of Bella, and it's really my mom and I. And what I do is I write through the eyes of Bella as a child, and then I flip it and I write through the eyes of the adult. And so I just wrote, it's going to come out next week, the one about her first snowfall, you know, that she's really able to enjoy. And but the Christmas one, it actually is a true story. When I was old enough to know who Santa is, my mom, I kid you not, my mom turned to me. It's like, your father and I were up till 2 a.m. setting up those Paradise Estate houses and da da da. And I, as an adult woman, I can still close my eyes and see the Christmas tree and see those estates set up. So that's also another idea of putting those blocks into the book for parents, because again, that's what I'm dealing with, is like my relationship with my mom, like not understanding why my mom's tired on Christmas morning, not understanding what, like for her birthday, for example, her birthday blog, I wrote that Bella was tugging on her mom's dress and her mom looked at her disgruntled and then her face softened and she pulled her up on her hip. And now from Bella's mom's perspective, which is totally my mom, like I write, I was up late, I was trying to make this perfect, and I'm talking to Bob's mother, my mother-in-law, and I feel this tug and I realize it's my daughter and I feel so bad because I'm just tired. And you know, it's about it, I feel it's about, for me, it's about me meeting my mom halfway, understanding she really was trying to be the best mom she could be. And again, I see it also for me sharing it, not just for the men and women who are in their parenting journey, but they're also either in that parent journey or maybe they're not there yet. They are also healing from their own parent relationships. Because I realize, like, part of this beauty of healing from these things is not only having a deeper spiritual connection to my mom, because she does send me signs like all the time. Like, I pray, and even though they may not show up, like, she always finds a way to show up and like let me know she's there in beautiful ways. And but I realize, like, if I want to be a wife, if I want to be a good mom, if I want to be a good author, I need to work through these things. Like, if I want to be the best version of me, I need to do this. Like, this is my choice. This is my responsibility to me. And there's something really amazing about that too.
That is, I love that. I feel like we could talk for so much more. I have so many more questions, but for the respect of our listeners, I'm sure they're busy moms. We'll have to just chat about another time. But I would love to say, like, where can we find more about you?
Absolutely. So I have, my website is www.ccokl.com. I do have an email list. So I would love, again, if I have the gift for your audience, it's a Valentine's color and drawing now. I do different freebies seasonally, and if you're on my email list, these freebies and these gifts, I always include them in my newsletters. I always make sure you have access to everything. So if you're thinking, oh, I signed up, I'm not going to get, like, no. I'm always giving goodies. I'm always thinking of new ideas for you guys. And I would love for you to keep me posted on the books. Like, that's like a really, really exciting step in my journey. And I just can't wait for families to have them in their hands. Like, I think that's going to be a really exciting moment. And I can't wait for it.
Yeah, I can't wait to see them. And I will link all of your connections down below.
Yes, so, absolutely.
Thank you so much for joining us. I was so excited to talk to you.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you. Same here. I appreciate it.
And thank you guys, everyone, for listening to the Early Motherhood Guide podcast. And I will see you guys next week.